Hello everyone, we are finally back for our new video. This one will be about the castle of Comarque, which is one of the most beautiful castles in France, according to us, of course, but it's worth a lot. And not only is it a beautiful castle, but it's also an amazing site in every way. We're going to see the details of it together. Let's go! Comarque is situated in Dordogne, between Les Aisies and Sarlat, in the heart of the Périgord Noir. After parking, you need to walk for 600 meters in a deep forest to access this privileged site. Before you even see the castle, you reach a spring of fresh water. This water, under the protection of Saint John, explains the presence and the occupation of the people for at least 15,000 years. You can even drink it, it's very good. And beam! It appears in your face, the most beautiful castle of Comarque. It might look very isolated now, but it used to be a very important axis of passage between Périgueux and Sarlat. On top of that, it was a frontier between the lands of the county of Périgord and those of the Abbey of Sarlat. Wait a minute, what is this castle I see? So anyway, the Comarques will come and settle the first tower on the top of the rock in the 12th century. But before we go in, just a few words about the prehistory of the surroundings. Just so you know, the Beaune Valley is worldwide famous for its prehistoric sculptures. Cap Blanc is national heritage, it's open to the public and the link is in description. La Grèze isn't, but there is a beautiful bison. Locelle's Venus, that was found just in front of Comarque under the castle of Locelle. And of course, Comarque's cave, which unfortunately isn't open to the public, even though it has 70 beautiful sculptures, including this full-size horse. The troglodytes. These beautiful rock dwellings that can be found under and around the castle are the testimony of a large habitat. A whole village prospered at the foot of the castle for hundreds of years. In troglodyte regions, the rock was often carved into making surveillance spots such as this one. This way, you could prevent the attacks and warn each other in case of danger. Once aware of this dreadful danger, a few families could find refuge in these rock shelters. There, they just had the necessary comfort to hold the siege for a few days. In this typical troglodyte shelter, you will also hide the animals, because you did not want them to be taken by the enemy. They were at the same time food as well as tools. In other words, they were wealth. The most important room in a shelter is obviously the bedroom. They were also carved in the rocks. As you can see, the chapel. The chapel being built above one of the gates is not random. At the time, entering a religious place with weapons was strictly forbidden, and therefore it was a common practice. Believe it or not, it did protect a lot of places. Let's see the inside. Fun fact, it is very possible that the chapel was rebuilt here from another place, because all the stones of the vault have been marked, which is perfectly normal. It's usually a way for the stonecutter to be paid and an indication for the mason so that he knows where to place the stone. But in this case, all the marks are the same and they're all visible, so it probably indicates that they were all marked from another spot to be transported here and then reinstalled on the chapel of Comarque. That's interesting. But wait a minute, how come there's the coat of arms of the Beynac family in the chapel of Comarque? It requires some explaining. Comarque was a co-lordship, which means the same stronghold was shared by several lords. Understudied but quite frequent, it is also the case in Saint-Cyr-la-Popie, for example, in Lot, or in Tour de Merle, in Corrèze, and even in Lastour, in Aude. Obviously, the Comarques were the first to come. But in the 13th century, they left for the Crusades, so they entrusted the management of the site to the Hospitallers' Order. Surprise, surprise! At their return, they found that the Beynacs were in place after some business with the Hospitallers. So now we have two lords on the stronghold, and all along the 13th century, more will come. Cendrieux and Gondrix's houses.
Gondrix and Cendrieux, with its beautiful oven.
Now we're inside the Gondrix house, and as you can see, it has the particularity of being built half troglodyte, which means using the natural rock for the animal level, the lower level. And they even had these so that they could tie up the animals with a rope. This house is the oven house. The entry of the oven is inside the fireplace.
Now these two houses and these two families were quite close because they were only separated by this tiny street. But at the end of it, you can clearly see what's left of the ancient drawbridge, which was their only private access to their homes.
The moat.
The presence of this drawbridge was necessary because of the moat. Here, it was carved 4 meters below and 4 meters thick, so that only they could access their houses through here. If we continue to the top, there are two other private entrances we can clearly see. Above here, there was the access to the Escar family, and above that, there was the private access to the Comarque house. Although this looks like a street, it was really a moat separating those two lords of the co-lordship. And this moat was actually also used as a sewers. All of the used waters coming from the top would come inside and then connect with the great moat that we've seen before. Or they could also be collected in this tiny sewer here and go all the way to the oven.
The Escar house. Okay, so the sound was awful, so we added some off comment and some extra pictures to make you understand about the quarry. A lot of the stones were extracted directly on the site, but the main quarry was in the forest just before the spring.
Now I'm standing before the house of the Escar, but I'm not going to bore you with their story because first of all, it's very cold, and second of all, there's nothing about them in the archives, so... What is remarkable about this site is the subtlety and the skill with which they superimpose the carved blocks to the natural rock. You can actually barely see it.
Comarque house.
Originally, the Comarque family had a tower of 4 stories. Nowadays, what you can see is only half of it. Because of these matters of height of the tower, there will be a lot of lawsuits between the Comarque family and the Beynac family. You can find them in the archives. It's always about the height of the tower and who's going to have the highest. First, the Beynacs will add a few meters to their keep tower in the end of the 1300s. Then the Comarques will win a lawsuit allowing them to reach the same height with their own tower. That way we can know exactly what's missing of the height of the original tower. Finally, in the early 1500s, the Beynac will add the last, but not the least, of the towers to reach the highest of the valley.
Yeah, things don't change. The barbicane.
This structure was the barbicane. It was quite common to a lot of castles to have a military building before you reached the actual castle. It possessed several entrances. The first one that led directly the Lord to the chapel. The second one that was for the Lord himself. And then the third one in the hall over there that would lead to the drawbridge so that anybody else but the Lord could come in the castle.
Comarc and Beynac Castle.
So I'm going to penetrate the castle with the key, but I have to be careful not to be hit by a stone thrown from the machicolations. It is quite a typical manner of defending the castle as well to install this staircase so high you would need a ladder to reach it. And then the guards could access the top with no specific protection. But then, for anybody who would try to access the castle by force, it would be quite difficult because from this door over there, or from the top of the machicolations, they would hit them with stones and arrows, which would make the climb very difficult.
Inside the castle. The keep tower is double. On the right, the original one, which was built by the Comarcs in the 12th century, and on the left, the addition of the Beynacs in the Gothic period. The machicolations were clearly inspired by the Pope's palace in Avignon.
This beautiful terrace used to be a room, but not just any room. It was actually the most important of the castle. You could name it the Great Hall. That is where the Lord would receive his guests, visitors, ambassadors for treaties of peace or anything, or just simply the people of his land. For example, if you wanted to get married, you needed to register. You would do it in this room with the presence of the Lord. And if somebody had his farm burnt during a period of famine by some outlaws, he could ask reparation with the Lord, with his own guards. So that's where it would happen. As you can see, the ceiling has crumbled down a long time ago. It was probably around the 16th century and the wars of religion. That room has a name in Latin. It's called aula, A-U-L-A. And it would be the origin of the word hall.
Now let's penetrate the keep tower.
Here you have what it looks like.
From there, it connects with the original Romanesque keep tower. From the outside, the building has the exact same volume as the Gothic one, but because the walls were much thicker, the rooms inside are much smaller. And what do we see from the window? And we keep climbing.
And here we are, we finally reached the top. From here we have the most glorious view evoking everything we've talked about. For example, the Valley of the Burn, the Castle of Locelles again, the troglodyte village at the bottom, and the entirety of the site with all of the tower houses.
But the story doesn't end here. After being abandoned in the early 1600s, the castle would be used as a quarry and slowly be recovered by all the vegetation. And this very romantic ruin lost in the forest will give way to lots of legends less and less believable. Of course, the keep tower is supposedly haunted. Of course, the inside of the castle harbors a chest of precious gems. Even better, the Ark of the Covenant itself would be buried in Comarque. As it turns out, it is represented on their coat of arms. No wonder a lot of artists and film directors were also inspired by the place. Ever After and The Duelist, for example. The first movie by Ridley Scott. Literature also digs Comarque, and the famous author Martin Walker was also inspired by the place. In 1915, the famous Abbot Breuil will authenticate the sculptures of the cave. In 1943, it will be classified as National Heritage. After 400 years of oblivion, the heir of the Comarque family bought his own heirloom back in order to save it. He will open it to the public in 2000, and after 50 years of work and a brilliant restoration of the Lord's lodging, the castle gets nearly 50,000 visitors per year. And there's even more. You can rent it, and it shelters events such as open-air cinema, murder parties, concerts. So there's only one question you should ask yourself. Voulez-vous coucher avec le château de Comarque?